Hi, Danny. You well?
Yes, very well, thank you, Philip. Thank
Good.
you.
Lovely to finally talk face to face. We really appreciate you being involved.
And that picture and audio is okay for you?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, that's absolutely fine. Yeah, that'll come through. Is there any way of going landscape or yeah, that's got your full screen there.
And then I'll click that. Is that better?
Yeah, that's perfect. That's lovely.
Okay.
Yeah, wonderful. So the first thing I want to ask Tony, and I'm sure my viewers will want to know, is how you got into the film business in the first place. What made you want to pursue it, and how you began that path?
Okay, well, it was my father was an actor here in Australia, a musical theatre actor. He had a very fine bass baritone voice, and did some of the original big musicals, Desert Song, Maid of the Mountain, White Horse Inn, Lilac Time, really beautiful musicals of the 30s, 40s, and 50s. So Dad, yeah, he was an actor with a very famous theatrical company here in Australia, called J.C. Williamson's. A lot of very fine English actors came out to Australia and worked for J.C. Williamson's, touring musical theatre and certainly straight plays, straight drama. J.C. Williamson's is well known throughout the world. So I start. My father did a lot of shows for them. When I left school, I did a couple of little kind of jobs. I was interested in kind of creating a for window dressing, Philip, of all things, and it kind of showed me later that dressing a window, being what's called a window dresser, is similar to being an actor. You take an empty space in an apartment store, and you're given the task of dressing this window with clothing or with white goods or with something. And now it's up to you as the window dresser to create an atmosphere in that empty space to highlight what you're trying to sell. So I did that through the day. Of a night, I worked in one of J.C. Williamson's theaters as a what's called a dresser. And a dresser is someone that helps the leading actors in that play or that musical in and out of quick changes. So if someone comes off stage, they have to take the wardrobe, the costume they have on, off, and get another one on quickly. Then a dresser is there to help the actor with Velcro and clips and buttons and the rest of it. So I was doing that of a night at the wonderful Her Majesty's Theatre in Sydney. Then I started taking singing classes off Richard Few. I started movement classes. Never dance classes. I was never going to be a dancer, but I knew I needed to learn how to move. So I did that with the wonderful Ronnie Arnold, who was a dancer himself and a dance teacher here in Sydney. I did that classes until I thought I was ready to audition. I started auditioning for shows. Made my first show, and then went on from there.
Lovely. And at a certain point, you made a transition to the UK. How did that sort of
Yeah, well, I did theatre and a little bit of television here in Sydney with the ABC, which is similar to the BBC there in London. So I did some played some characters in various shows for them. Then I did a film, my very first film I played a character in. The film was called They're a Weird Mob. An Italian actor came out, Walter Chiari came out from Italy to play the lead in that film. I played a character, and the character went very well. The director was very happy with the work I did. Then I went back to doing theatre when I finished by a couple of weeks on that film. Then I went back to theatre. Then a year or so after that, the producers of that film, of They're a Weird Mob, then put together a television series to shoot a pilot of a series titled Skippy. Mm. So then they got in touch with me. They phoned me and said, Tony, we know you're doing a show at the moment. When does that finish? We're going to shoot a pilot for a show we hope to go called Skippy, titled Skippy. There is a helicopter ranger in that show that we'd like you to play. Mm-hmm. So I finished the project, the play I was on. Then we shot the pilot of Skippy. And then that's history. I mean, the show was an immediate success here in Australia. It was an instant success in London and England, especially in the north of England. It was a big hit in Africa, through Europe, Japan. It was enormous in Japan. When I finished filming on that, about end of 1968, they asked me to go on and do another year. But I was more interested in not playing the same character and becoming hyped playing that helicopter ranger. So I took the gamble. I thanked them. I left the show. I got on a big plane and I flew to London. Then I picked up an agent there in the West End. And I started what you do as an actor, wherever you live. I started go sees and I started auditioning.
And I take it that the Persuaders came about from one of those auditions and somebody thought you fit the role. How did the Persuaders come into your life?
The first work I was offered was, the first work I was offered was a film with Mick Jagger. Mick was going to come back to Australia to do Ned Kelly. A film on a famous bush ranger here in Australia. Mick was coming back to do that, and another production was being set up at the same time. And they had asked the other production that had Albert Finney coming out to play. They asked me to play Dan Kelly, one of the brothers. Fortunately or unfortunately, that second production was cancelled. The Mick Jagger film went ahead. But in doing that in London at the time, Peter Collinson, who was on the film, was then off that film and given a film by Columbia Pictures originally it was called The Dubious Patriots, to shoot in Turkey with Charles Bronson and Tony Curtis. It was later retitled You Can't Win Them All, which was a big film at that stage. There was a character that I was asked to play, Reese, one of Tony Curtis's gang of bad people. So I went off to Turkey and worked there for the next 3 months on that film with Peter Collinson directing. And Peter had said a couple of nice things about my work to a director friend of his back in London at Pinewood, who was starting to put together The Persuaders. So when I finished in Turkey, I came back to London and I was asked about a character that you saw in The Persuaders. And I went and did that down on Studios L&M at Pinewood. And that's how that came about, Philip.
Perfect. So you already had a bit of a relationship with Tony Curtis that probably helped being on set. How did you find working with Tony?
Oh, fabulous. I mean, he is extreme, admirable, fine, funny fellow. There's a lot of laughing with Tony. He he's just one of those characters. So it was a joy working with him in Turkey with Charlie Bronson. Charlie and I got along very well. And then when I came back to London, it was great working with Tony on The Persuaders and meeting and becoming a lifelong friend of the wonderful Roger Moore. So, I mean, it was a great joy for me to play that character, to rework again with Tony Curtis and to meet Roger. And we remained very close friends for the rest of our lives.
Wonderful. Do you find that the relationship between Tony and Roger, they got on well on set? Was it similar to their characters in the show, or were they quite different people?
They were kind of the same. I mean, Roger was kind of Roger in most things he did. Roger was a leading man, and you hired Roger because he was an Englishman that had a little twinkle in his eye and had a manner about him that's what you required for the character. So I forget the character's name in The Persuaders, Lord, whoever it was.
Lord Betsy Clare, yes.
Yeah, correct. Roger was perfect for it. And the second character that Tony Curtis played was this guy from the Bronx who was kind of funny and flippant. And that's Tony kind of in real life. And so he just replayed that in The Persuaders as Daniel. And I thought the chemistry between the two of them was pretty interesting.
Definitely. So when you read the character, did the character change much from the page to screen? How much influence would you have had to bring your own thoughts to the role?
Well, good question. What I've always done as an actor, Philip, and I continue to do it, I look at what I can find within the character I've been asked to play that I can have a moment. I can find something that makes that man I'm playing, I hope, me. Or conversely, me, him. I've done it in all the films I've ever done. I try not to act the man I'm playing. I try to be the man I'm playing in everything I do. And so I found this character of this assassin. I didn't want to play him as an assassin. I tried to play him in such a manner that this was his job. This was his profession. He wasn't, this is what he did. And I tried to have that element with the character, and in the brief moments you have when you shoot television, I hope it worked. The character seemed to work. Everyone seemed to be happy with it. It seemed to be a believable character. So that's all I can do as an actor.
Well, yeah, and I think the character comes off very well indeed. So I think you did a really good job. I had a question from come in about your co-stars. Because Catherine Schell plays your sister. What was she like to work with?
Well, I mean, she was fabulous. And it was all too brief. We got along extremely well. I liked the manner in which she attached to her character. I thought the two characters kind of complemented each other. I think there was a believability between the two characters. I don't think the audience sat back and thought, oh, that's an actor playing that role and that's an actor playing that role. I think the audience genuinely believed that these people knew each other and knew personally what they're about. So I thought the working relationship was great, and the personal one was as well. I think she's a wonderful woman, and it was a joy to be able to do that.
Wonderful. Because another the person that you had quite a few scenes was Bernard Hoffel. I don't know if you remember Bernard at all.
Oh, no, I remember Bernard, and I knew him for the characters that he'd played in many, many television and film roles in England. And I would presume, and in the brief chat we had, in the theatre work that he had done. So I had great admiration for him. That's the joy you have in England, and have always had, that when you do your series there, you have such a wealth of fine actors, usually all theatrically trained, usually all come up through that strong touring companies of theatre, that then discover film and television, warm to that genre. So it's there's always solid work from everyone in England, but I loved. When I did a film in Malta titled Eyewitness or Sudden Terror in some markets, that was a joy to do as well with the wonderful Susan George. That was just wonderful. Jeremy Kemp, Peter Bowles, Peter Vaughan, Lionel Jeffries. I mean, what a cast to be involved with. So all solid, everyone solid.
And so many of those names you just mentioned also appeared in the Persuaders, Susan George, Peter Bowles, Peter Vaughan. So again,
correct.
A lot of crossing between films and TV. Do you remember anything particularly about Peter Vaughan?
Pardon?
Do you remember anything particular about Peter Vaughan?
Not really. We just... yeah, it's such a long time ago, Philip, that I work with. I wish I had stayed in London and done more work there. But I stayed 5 years, and then came back to do a film here and then started going to America. So, I loved every moment of sitting with Pete Vaughan and Jeremy Kemp. I mean, Jeremy is one of the great kind of one-offs. He's a wonderful guy and a hell of an actor, Jeremy. So I was surrounded with very strong English character actors. I mean, I thought it was great. I loved filming in Malta. John Huff directed that one. I think John was a splendid director. I was greatly honored to be in that. That was kind of the beginning of his career. So, and Susan has always, Susan's still a friend. I still converse with Susan all these years later. I used to see her in Los Angeles. It's a funny old world to be still talking and connecting with Susan after, you know, all these years, nearly 40, over 40 years.
Yeah, that's right. What was it like? What was your memories of working at Paramount Studios? Was it a good studio to work in?
Well, yeah. I mean, my main memory was down at Pinewood there. Philip, and the other films have been basically on location in Africa. The film I did down there for Hammer Productions, Malta, obviously, Turkey, obviously. I mean, I think The Persuaders was the longest studio shoot in England that I had. Everything else was on location. So The Persuaders was great to be in that studio. I mean, just to drive through those Pinewood gates every morning was a real, real buzz for me. You know, it was wonderful.
Yeah, it is very much sort of holy ground, isn't it, when it comes to filmmaking. So, yeah, the feel to be there must be immense.
Yeah, absolutely.
Do you remember, the episode was directed by Leslie Norman. Do you recall the director at all?
I do. It would seem that Leslie was a friend of Peter Collinson's, who directed the film I did in Turkey. And apparently Peter had said some kind of nice things to Leslie about my work in his film in Turkey. And that was, I think, or I was led to believe, one of the main reasons I was offered the role in that Persuaders episode with Leslie directing, yeah.
I just wonder about Leslie's directing style, whether he was somebody who very much let the actors get on with it, or whether he was more sort of,
I think for memory, he allowed the actors, as long as the actors hit their marks, as long as where the blocking had been done, most actors that do television and film at that level. We know where the camera is. We know where our key lighting is. We know where not to move because the camera will be shooting off the set. So within the frame that we all understand, Leslie, like most directors, if we've had the discussion about what is required in this scene, the director will say, what I need to have happen in this scene is this moment of intrigue or this moment. I mean, the film industry is, and television to a degree, is about moments. You find moments, and it may be just pausing a little on your dialogue to hold that moment that makes, I hope, makes an audience think, what the hell's he going to say? What the hell's he going to do? And that's what you want. You want an audience to go on a journey with you. I think Leslie, along with all good directors, they hire actors that they know are going to deliver the dialogue. They know they're going to deliver a performance that will be hopefully of interest.
The Persuaders was shot on film, which was fairly unusual for UK television at that time. I was just wondering, working on TV back in the 70s and 60s was like compared to working in Australia or American television. What was that like?
Well, no, it's all the same, Philip. If you've worked on film in England or Australia or Africa or New Zealand, if you've worked on film and you go to another country, it is exactly the same process. It's exactly the same, you know. It's not new. The difference between working on film and working on video on a series in a studio, now that is different because you'll have four cameras on you. In film, you have one camera. You know, that's focused on you, and the lens will come off, and the lens will be a 50 mil, an 80 mil, 100 mil, or it'll be a 25 mil, or whatever the size of the shot that the director sees this scene being shot. The master shot of most scenes would be on a 20 mil, 25 mil lens. Then that lens comes off and a 50 mil lens goes on, and you shoot the scene again, now in close-up or in two shots. So, and then it's all edited together. So so the process of being an actor on film is slightly different to being a series actor on videotape in a studio, because you have a vision switcher who's up in the control room with the director, who's switching the cameras between camera one, camera two, camera three, camera four. So you as an actor have got to know when you're transferring a look from a camera that's shooting me here, that I know the vision switcher is going to throw that switch, and this camera that's on me is going to turn off. And as I turn my head, this camera that's over there is going to pick me up. So it's a matter of, it's a different movement. It's a different manner to the manner in which you work as an actor technically. Not with the character, but technically between film and video television in a studio.
And of course, you've got that live element as well, haven't you? So it's recording pretty much like a play.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's like doing a play with the cameras around. Film is different because it's kind of more individualized. You know, television is, you've got four actors in this scene, so the four actors are doing the scene at the, like a play, and the choreography and the camera planning has been done. So your particular moment in the scene is being picked up by the camera that's on you, and the editing's being done up in the control room by the vision switcher cutting between the cameras.
I had a question about, there was some location shooting on The Persuaders albeit briefly, there was a location called Ossley Park, which is just on the outskirts of London. Do you remember the location at all?
I have to be brutally honest, I don't. I can remember because it was quite a brisk day or days we were filming out there. And I have a slight remembrance of the layout of the location we were on. To be honest, I don't, nothing kind of jumps out at me to say, you know, in a remembrance of that location.
Yeah. Would you have watched the episode when it was broadcast? You'd like to watch your work?
No, I didn't. I rarely do, Philip, for no reason, really, other than once I've done it, once I've watched the rushes or the dailies, then it's really, I don't have a say in it. There's only quite a few actors in the world that have editorial say. So I deliver what I hope is the correct performance that the director and the producers want, with my, I hope, added interest in this man I'm playing, whatever I'm doing, that I hope they discover something from my performance that they find interesting and maybe edit a little more around the character I'm playing than was maybe conceived originally. That's what I suggest to all my students that I teach. If you're in front of a camera, if you think you're not going to be seen too well or you're not saying too much, I don't have my students think that way. Everyone that's on that set is important. So if you bring that vitality, if you bring that importance to what you're doing, you know, the director will find you. The cameraman will find you. And suddenly, you know, and then suddenly when that scene's edited, your character is having a little more on-screen performance than maybe you thought you would, because you've delivered something interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. Have you seen the episodes since then?
I did, Philip, and I thank you for sending me that little link. It was a little trip down memory lane. I loved it. I wish I'd have taken the suit I was wearing. I like that suit.
Nice, isn't it?
It was wonderful to see some of the scenes again. It was a joy, and I thank you for that.
Oh, no, my pleasure. It certainly holds up very well, I think, even in 50 years.
It does.
Yeah, and I think that the Persuaders series in itself is highly regarded as one of the best filmed British series there ever was, and I think you can see it in.
Yeah, well, I think you're correct, and I was just thinking then as we were talking, Philip, it may have been, or it's possible that it was the beginning of the television and film genres of the buddy films, when two characters held the series or the film together. I mean, a lot of television series that came after that, there wasn't just that the kind of one lead. There were two guys or two girls. So it became, I think, the way that Tony Curtis and Roger played and their work together, I think, opened the door to creative writers and producers to find other subjects, other projects that were buddy films.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point, because you had series like the Saints beforehand. Of course, that was a one-person lead. So I think it was very fresh at the time, certainly, to have. I think you've probably had some spy shows that might have been sort of two-handers, but to have that kind of comedy, that light sort of, I think, was quite unique at the time.
I tell you a series I loved that was done in England. I'd love to have done an episode. I loved Edward Woodward's Callan. I loved that series. I loved the character of Lonely. I just thought, what a brilliant character to write and to cast. This sad man that just kind of blended into the shadows of the streets of London. But he was important to Callan. But it was wonderful. I loved Callan. I thought it was a great series.
Is there any other British shows it would have liked to have appeared on?
That I would have liked to?
Yes.
Oh, well, gosh, there's many of them. I'd certainly like to have done Callan. I would like to have done, I think, with Robert Vaughan, that series that Robert did about the same time that I was there doing Persuaders, the Protectors.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
There was a that, and that looked kind of interesting as well. The Colditz series, on the prison of war camps, they always interested me. There's lots of material that came out of London that most actors would have liked to have been a part of.
Some very good TV coming out in that time period. Just like thinking of your Persuades episode, do you have when you rewatched it, was there a scene that you particularly liked, or a favourite moment, or anything that stood out as being, oh, that was really good?
The scenes that I watched, and I watched most of the clip that you sent me, no, there wasn't any one particular one that jumped out. I liked the construction of a couple of the scenes. There was one when the two of us walked out of a room and we heard the phone go downstairs and the butler or someone answered the phone and I picked up the spare phone and listened to it. I thought that little moment then between us worked quite well. So, there were some nice little moments. I enjoyed it, Philip. I enjoyed it.
Wonderful. Are you surprised that people are so interested in the show 50 years on? And did you find that the attention to your work surprises you still?
No, I don't think I'm surprised. I'm delighted that there are people throughout the world that like watching television and film from another period, when things were not so tricked up, when actors did, I did most of my stunts back in those days. I did a stunt in the film that was shot in Malta, Eyewitness, a car stunt that at the time was written up as nearly the second best car chase to Bullet. This in the Steve McQueen film. It's a hell of a scene that I drove in. I had glass throughout my eyes when the windscreen smashed. Johnny Huff had cameras on the car. I had to use two cars because the cars just got beaten up, being smashed against the brick walls on this chase sequence. I like it. Because I think people knew it was the actor really being involved, unless it was a very dangerous stunt and you had a stunt double in to do. I do my own horse riding and I've done a lot of big horse films, war films and vintage films, big ones with Tom Selleck, Quigley Down Under, The Light Horseman, where I played a character that led the Australian Light Horse against the cannons at Beersheba in Palestine in the First World War. That's a hell of a film. And all the actors did their own writing in that film. It was it was phenomenal. And I do. I ask my students these days to do some stunt training, learn how to throw a punch, learn how to take a punch, learn how to use a gun, use a knife, use a sword. Because they get into a film and they can handle the stunt, then it gives the director and the cameraman the opportunity to keep the camera on them, you know, and there's no cutting away to an obvious stuntman or stunt double. And I admire and always have the work of a lot of my friends that do stunt work. But if the lead actors can do their stunt work up until right till it gets real dangerous, then the camera can stay in on them. The audience knows it's them.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got to give Tommy Cruise 100 points. I mean, the stuff that Tom does on his films is unbelievable.
Yes. It's a surprise he's still alive, really.
He jumps out of buildings. He jumps out of planes. I mean, he is phenomenal.
He is, isn't he? You mentioned your background in being a dresser. So when it comes to characters' costumes, I take it that's quite an important element of finding the character. Do you find that you can have that most directors allow you to have that input in how you're dressed?
Oh yeah. I mean, if I'm playing a character if I'm playing a character that's a military officer, I can't play around with the uniform because the uniform needs to be what the uniform needs to be. Yeah. You know, I can't detail it to me to the, it has to be the tie, it has to be what is correct for that military character. But if I'm playing a character that I can wear an outfit where I can stylize it a little myself to show a little of what this man wearing this clothing is about, then yeah, I will. You know, I will do something. I will wear a badge, which I've done in a couple of films on a beret. I can remember on a beret I wore a specific badge on that beret, which showed that I'd come from an English regiment. It just gave the character some sort of background. Everyone wouldn't have known that, but someone in the audience would have said, "Hey, that's a Dorsetshire badge," and it would have just, I hope, added some interest to the character. I know another film, I made a pipe myself to smoke, and of course this man would have made his own pipe. He wouldn't have bought a pipe from the local store. So I made my own pipe, and it became a part of me, and it was great. If I can create something with the wardrobe I'm wearing to enhance the character or to add another moment of interest to the character, then I will say to the director, "Do you mind if I do this?" And in just about every occasion, the director will say, "No, that's a great idea. Great." I think the wardrobe's fine. But sometimes, I know I've done films, Philip, where I haven't wanted to think about the wardrobe. I just wanted to think about the man that I was about to play. So I would say to the wardrobe designer, I don't care what you give me. I want you to do your creative work on what this man, you think this man would wear.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'll be happy with it. And I love doing that because now I just completely think about the man who's wearing these clothes. They're not that important to me. They're clothes that this man just put on. He was not the sort of man that would try and color coordinate or style or try and look hip or fancy. He would just put a shirt on that maybe wasn't ironed. I didn't want to think about the clothing. I just wanted to walk into the trailer or the dressing room and the wardrobe that the creative designer thought this man would be wearing was there. So I just put it on and then I would just keep the man I was playing and the wardrobe just became a part of me without me thinking about it.
And how much does the character's voice come in? Because something like the Persuaders, you have an accent to work with, and is that part of finding the character, or is there any accents you think, oh my God, I've got to do this accent, I'm going to struggle with this one?
Sure. Well, on that one, a couple of people, a couple of the characters had to have similar sort of accents, So it was, I just wanted to hear what they were doing when we rehearsed. I just wanted to hear how heavily they were concentrating on the accent. And I just kind of slid in there and just phrased and used an accent that wasn't British, it wasn't European as such. It was kind of, you didn't know if he came from Denmark, Norway, Sweden. You didn't know where he came from. And that was fine with me. That was fine. He didn't need to be kind of that specific. As long as I made the character, I hope, interesting, that was what I needed to, what I wanted to do as the actor, was to make the character interesting.
I have to ask you about one particular film, because it looks like it was probably a lot of fun. It was Creatures the World Forgot, with opposite Judy Edge.
Yep. What a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful human being Julie was. God rest her soul. No longer with us. Julie passed about 2 or 3 years ago. I grabbed that film because it was just interesting. I was in London. I just finished doing, I can't remember. It was either the film in Malta or The Persuaders. I just can't think at the moment what I was doing. I'd have to look at my filmography to remember. When Columbia Pictures, it was a co-production between American Columbia Pictures and Hammer Productions, the famous Hammer Productions in London. When they came to me, or my agent, and said, we have a character in Africa with a brother, it's a like Cain and Abel, good brother, bad brother, kind of prehistoric period. I thought, wow, this is interesting, because there was no written dialogue as such. We sat with the director and created sounds, which I know sounds strange here now, but we created emotional sounds to fit the emotion of what we were doing at that time in the film. And that interested me as an actor. And that's all I ever want to do in my life, is to do work that's interesting. And I had never done a film or a play or a television that didn't have kind of written dialogue. So it was interesting. So I loved it. I loved Africa. I loved the group, the actors that I work with on that. Loved the South African guys that I met. It was just a hell of a film. And Julie was sensational. I think Julie had just won Miss World at the time. And you would not get a more level-headed, natural human being than Julie Edge. She was just a joy. And she was going out with a friend of mine at that stage that was one of the manager or the manager at Apple Records, at Apple in London. So she was great. I just loved her. We had great fun. My big friend on that film was Nancy Holmes, who was an American PR photographer. Nancy came down for Columbia Pictures and shot lots of stuff on that film. And so it was great having Nancy down there, because she was a great pal of mine in London. She was on the film in Turkey as well. So it was great having her. But it was just a joyous time to be in a great country, unbelievable scenery, terrific cast. Mm. Mainly for about two thirds of the film, we're out on location, so you know, sleeping out in the savannah, out in the bush. Mm. It was well, what a time! It was great. Mm.
Yeah, it looks like it was fantastic. Do you remember the director of that, Don Chaffee?
Don Chaffee, yeah, I sure do. Don mm. came through after he finished that film. He went back to London. Then he came, I think he was then coming to Australia to do a picture here or New Zealand. I can't remember if it was here or New Zealand. And I went back to London and I missed him when he came down here to Australia. But he was great, Don. You know, he was an interesting director, had a good resume himself. I loved him. We got along great.
Because a lot of my audience will recognize the name from episodes of the Avengers that he directed. And of course, there's lots of links with the Avengers crew and cast and things like the Persuaders.
Correct.
You did mention the working with Tom Selleck. Quigley Down Under. Also opposite Alan Rickman. I wonder if you had a memory of Alan you'd like to share.
Oh, Alan was, that was amongst a couple of sad days in the last few years of my life when I heard that morning that Alan had passed away. It just bowled me over. I mean, we were extremely close. We worked together. The character I played was his foreman, his guy, you know. So I worked with Alan every day on that shoot. What a sadness. What a loss to the film and theatre worlds. Just wonderful presence. Just a lovely actor to work with. He had Alan was a, we were kind of alike. We both looked for moments. We both, when we played scenes together, we looked at each other's eyes. I have a big thing when I work as an actor. I watch your eyes. And Alan had a similar, and some of the scenes we had, some of the moments we had were just fabulous. I loved them.
I also want to ask one person you work with, John Melion. I can pronounce
John.
It. John Melion, Meilon.
John Melion.
You do? Yes, that's it. Sorry, yes.
Now, John did a lot of work in England.
He's very well known for fans, obviously, of Crocodile Dundee films and.
Correct.
You worked with him, I think, on a couple of occasions.
I did. I worked a fair amount of television drama with John. I did a couple of films. Inn of the Damned was one that I did with John. We did theatre together. I did a play with him at the Theatre Royal in Sydney. And we did... Rightly or wrongly, Philip, we did a fair bit of drinking together.
he's like a very good chap to know.
He was great, John. We were very close and did a lot of work together. But another one of my friends that is no longer here. So, good actor, John. Good actor. Mm.
So just about to start to wrap it up, I had one of my closing questions was just about how the film business has changed in your career, what it's like to make TV now and films versus, say, in the 60s and 70s. Any notable differences?
Well, there is, and I won't get into the rights or wrongs of it, but there's a certain manner now in casting, in scripting, that has to... be aware of what's going on with diversity, with in the social media, in just what's going on in life. It's that's kind of the major difference. And it's also the technical things now. There's so much CGI used in big films that I'm not a fan of, I've got to say. If there's supposed to be a special effects, let's try and work it out that it's real on the set. You know, let's not have a director say to me, "Now, Tony, see that mark I've got on the wall over there? This is what I'm going to do in the CGI. This is going to be happening. This is going to be happening." So, I mean, I can be in an empty kind of room with little marks on the wall with what's going to be edited in CGI after I finish my performance.
Yeah.
You know, I'm a bit old school, I suppose, Philip. I like the manner in which Italians still make their film, where the camera and the characters are important, that the camera becomes, Woody Allen does it a bit. He uses a subjective camera, that the camera is part of the dinner party or part of the whatever the scene is about. And you get a sense of that this is not being tricked up, that this is, these characters are real. I mean, it's just the way that it is, I suppose. It's the way that it is. I've got a feeling, unfortunately, Philip, not in my lifetime, I hope, but not long after I go, cinemas will start to disappear. I think most things will be live streamed on television. Netflix will become even more important. The Stan, all those streaming services. And I'm not putting that down. I mean, if you can go to your electrical store now and buy a television that's like, you know, in your measurements, like 5 yards wide and 3 yards, you know, and you can put that and cover your whole goddamn wall with this screen, you don't want to go to the movies. What do you want to go out and try and park a car, have your car broken into, maybe get accosted on the street, when you can just stream everything on your wall?
I think there's been dramatic changes, certainly at the time of the pandemic, where people have been forced to come up with new ideas. Whether you can go back from that, I'm not sure if you can, really.
But, I don't know. That is the big question. I mean, I know a lot of the soaps here, and certainly in America, and I presume in England, were so constructed during this pandemic that there was no touching, no two shots, that everything had to be plotted. When you see someone hold and caress someone, that someone was a goddamn dummy.
Yeah.
I mean, theater will be the same. You won't be able to, you'll have to adhere to the 1 yard distancing. So you've got to redirect, replot where these two characters that should be touching now can't touch.
Well, yes, I suppose if you've just got like a two-hander or a very small cast play, you can probably get around that. But if you've got huge musicals, that's the big question, isn't it? So,
it'll be interesting, Philip, how it all goes. But sadly, I can see the beautiful Art Deco cinemas, the pit palaces, disappearing.
Yeah.
I hope they don't. We have a couple of cinemas here in Sydney, and there's a few in Melbourne that are beautiful Art Deco theatres. You know, so what if they stop showing films? I don't know what the hell they're going to do.
That's right. I wanted to ask you briefly about the change in the Australian film industry, because now, of course, you watch a big Marvel film and already big blockbuster, and it's always said Australia. So why do you think Australia is now a real place to go now?
Well, it's certainly Queensland. Queensland have grabbed the market and have made things COVID safe up there for major productions and and Netflix. I think Netflix is shooting like 5 series right now up in Queensland. Yeah, they've worked out a fashion up there to have big major productions COVID safe. The dollar is still good against the American dollar, so an American can budget his show in the States at say $20 million, and he can come down here, shoot it as well, if not better, for $15 million.
Well, yes, no brainer.
Yeah. So as long as the parity between the Australian dollar and the American dollar stays where it is, there'll be lots of American dollars coming this way, because, you know, as they say in the classics, they get more bang for their bucks down here. And I suppose it's the same with the euro and the pound, that that rate against the Australian dollar it still makes it attractive to bring work down here, because the studios are as good, if not better, than most of the studios overseas. The locations are fantastic. Our crews are great. They're not as union structured as in England to a degree, and America. I mean, there's a lot of pluses here to have your production done in Australia, Philip.
And finally, Tony, do you have a project in your career that's your favourite from either film, TV, or theatre?
I don't. I have a couple that are kind of close to me, because I thought we all the actors and the directors and everyone kind of got it. I did a 10-hour miniseries titled The Anzacs. It was quite a big, it played quite well, I think, on Channel 4 in England. I'm not quite sure, but I played a character in that that I loved, a lieutenant who then became Captain Armstrong. The writing was great. The direction was, everything was good about the whole of that show. So I like the Anzacs, I hold that dear. I did a play for the ABC television here many years ago, playing a farmer, a sheep farmer, who was going through a drought, and the drought was going to beat him. He already had lost his family. He'd given away his sheepdogs because there wasn't the stock left. He was shooting sheep that were just dying of drought, of lack of water. His dams on his property had dried up. It was a brutal film to do, and an emotional one. And I did it, and I was awarded a couple of acting awards for that one. But it wasn't so much from that. It was just playing this man. And if you're a city-sider, to understand what men on the land go through, it was a journey I went on with this character. So I liked that a lot. I liked The Light Horseman, a big film I did on the Australian Light Horse Cavalry that charged the cannons and machine guns at Beersheba in Palestine during the First World War. That was a hell of a film to do. I played a man, Lieutenant Colonel William Bouchier, that led that charge, the Australian who later became the agent in London for Australia after the war. That was a hell of a film to do. There's been stuff that I carry close to me.
Have you done much theatre work over here in the UK?
No. I wish I had of, but when I got in there in 1968, I kind of went straight into film, then television. So the opportunity to either audition or see about doing theatre or going on tour just didn't present itself. I kind of jumped to Malta, then I jumped to Africa, and then work. A film came up back here in Australia, a picture called The Money Movers, that I came back to do, a great, terrific film. And then I started going to America. I did Murder, She Wrote over there in Los Angeles with the great Angela Lansbury. That was a joy. I mean, that was fabulous. And then I did Last Frontier over there in LA with Linda Evans. So, I'd like to have stayed and tested myself in theatre in London. Yes, I would have, but I didn't get the opportunity, or I didn't take the opportunity. I could have turned down work back then on film or television and focused on theatre, but I didn't, Philip.
Yeah, well, I suppose part of it is also going where the money is as well and taking the opportunity to come in.
And I knew I could probably always get theatre back here in Australia. And I came back and I directed theatre as well. I came back and did some plays, but I started directing theatre, which I love, and I hope to direct more for Queensland Theatre. I directed One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest for Queensland Theatre. That was received pretty well. I love theatre. It's where I started and where I still feel very comfortable. I love being in a theatre.
So that's where your career is taking at the moment. It's the directing is also acting.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Well, yes, it sounds wonderful. Do you have any final comments you'd like to make about your career or anybody that you haven't mentioned that you would like to? We did mention Tom Selleck.
Tom. Well, I did that Quigley Down Under with Tom and. He was terrific to work with, Tom. We became good pals. And when I go back to Los Angeles, I always get to see him. We have a meal together. And I have a daughter named Hannah, who was little when I was doing the film with Tom. And he heard me talking to her on the phone. We were out in the middle of Australia in Alice Springs filming. And he heard me talking to my daughter back in Melbourne. And he said, I love that name of that Hannah for your daughter. And he called, he had a his first daughter, he called Hannah. So it was great. And I took him to a concert when we got down to Melbourne, the Bee Gees, I took him to see the Bee Gees live. And he was just knocked out, which it had to be. I mean, to go to a Bee Gees concert, every song they played was a major hit, either for them or some other artist who sang it. But their catalogue of hits is phenomenal.
They're one of the best groups in the world. Do you have any comments you'd like to make directly to the fans watching this, the Persuaders?
I hope, I'm sorry that some of them weren't there to do a direct Q&A with them. I hope, however you show this, Philip, or edit this up, I thank them for being fans of the show overall, and I hope somewhat of some of the work I've done that I appreciate. And I hope doing something back in London with this COVID problem that we all have is not completely gone. I'd love to get, I haven't been back in London for too long. I lived for a long time in Knightsbridge. I followed Chelsea. My eldest daughter, I called Chelsea after the football team. she's now 47, but I was there. I was there in the late 60s and early 70s when Chelsea was on fire. I was there with the great Georgie Best when Georgie used to come down from the north. I'd catch George in London at Tramp or one of the clubs there in the West End. It was great. I mean, I loved it. But so I hope to get back to London and I'd love to come back and do something, obviously, film, television or theatre. or teach. I'd love to come back and run a class there. So, yeah, I love you all. Thank you for your interest, Philip. Thank you for all your work you've done and the connection with you. I hope we keep this connection open and alive. Anything I can do for you or your guys there in the fan club, I can do this end, please just holler, let me know.
Oh, that's very kind. I will say let you know, Tony. Thank you very much. And thanks for spending all this wonderful time talking to me. It's been a delight, Tony, to talk to you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you, Philip.
Right. So take care. Enjoy your evening.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Do you want to turn your phone? I was just wondering if you want to turn your phone the other way, just so you are sort of aware that. So last time you mentioned that your father, of course, had a theatrical background, musicals, etc. We didn't talk about your mother, who I found out was a concert soprano. How much was she an influence in terms of your career path?
Well, not a lot, Philip, I have to admit. My mother didn't kind of do much with my career. She was like, I suppose, and unfortunately, most women of that era, that vintage, the husband kind of ruled the house, and mum back then in those days, we're talking a long time ago now, Philip, was there kind of more as a mother to me than a mentor or a tutor in theatre or in music. They were more discussions that I had with my father, if I really had any. It was not a close kind of family relationship, Philip. I was out quite early in my life working in theatre to begin with as a dresser. And while I was working backstage in the very big musicals that were on in this country at the time, I was then taking some singing classes and some movement classes. So when I thought I was ready to start auditioning, then I did. It was a career that I kind of started myself and motivated myself more than too much assistance from my parents.
And quite a hard profession to make a success of it and be consistent with. Did you find there was perhaps some pressure to perhaps not go into the arts? Was it considered to be a safe profession? Or
Well, you're right. But that discussion was never really had with my father. He ran a family iron foundry at the time. When he retired from his theatre life, my grandfather, his father, owned a foundry here in Sydney that did a lot of iron work for the government and the councils. My father went into that, and I think he half expected that either I would or my brother would go into that iron, into that foundry business with him. It was not a calling that consumed me or that I wanted to do. Without any kind of assistance or direction from my father, as I just suggested, I started to work backstage in the theatre and take classes until I thought I was ready to start auditioning, which was around 17, I think. And then I made my first show, which was then on stage. I'd done some a film and a television before my theatre life, but the first play I did was an Australian play by written by a poet back then that was called The Sentimental Bloke. It was a it was a play written by a poet who was very well known here for his poetry, and I did that play, a musical play, and then I auditioned. I just kept auditioning it. I think my second show was Annie Get Your Gun, the big American musical. Then I think it was How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying. And interspersed with theatre work was television work. You'd pick up a guest lead in a police show. We had several police shows being shot here back in that period. Homicide, Division 4, Solo. So I popped up and played guest leads in those in between theatre.
You mentioned Homicide, which I think you did 4 episodes of that, one opposite Pamela Stevenson. Do you remember Pamela at all?
Oh, I knew Pamela very well, and obviously when she married the great Scott, it was wonderful. She was a really great girl, Pamela, and when she married Billy, they were a great couple.
So one thing we didn't touch on last time, which we probably should have, was, of course, the success you had with Skippy. I just wonder how that sort of came into your life initially.
Well, it really came, Philip. I did a film in about 1964 that was quite a big film here and ended up being a reasonably successful film in England. And that was called They're a Weird Mob. It was a film about an Italian migrant that came to Australia and his life getting involved and confused with the change in the language. He was used to an Italian life, and here he was suddenly in Australia with men that drank in bars and pubs. And it was a very funny film. And Michael Powell, who was an English director, he came out from England to direct the film. And, you know, I got along very well with Michael. He liked the work that I did in that film. And then a couple of years after that film, the producers of that film became the producers of the Skippy television series. So when, you know, it was about 2 years after I finished that film, I went back to doing theatre. And then I received a call from John McCallum, who said, we're doing a television series titled Skippy. There's a character in there of a helicopter ranger. We think you're the right actor for it. Are you interested? And yes, I was interested because it was being shot on film. And to do a television series back then, not on videotape, but on film, was fabulous, and especially color film. So I kind of jumped at it, Philip, and played this character for a little over a year. Then I left the show and came to England.
I think initially it was a sort of the pilot, I think, was a 2-hour, I think it was Intruders, it was released theatrically. Was it always designed to be a feature film? Did they sort of cut it together like you did with other shows and then release it?
Yes, well, you're correct. We had been filming the series of Skippy for maybe 8 months or so before they structured the film of the Intruders. We shot the film as a separate identity, although it was the same subject matter. It was about Skippy, but it was different. It was a different production. We were shooting a television series, and then we shot the film basically at the same time.
I know they did a sort of similar thing with the Batman, Adam West movie. They were shooting the series and did the film. But a lot of shows like Man from U.N.C.L.E. were just splicing episodes together and releasing them theatrically. So it was quite nice. They also had the, I just wondered about the cast members of Skippy. Would they have any fond memories of the main leads of the series?
No, they're all very close and dear friends, and two of them still are. Unfortunately, my friend Ed Devereaux has passed away. I did theatre with Ed. I did two films with Ed. I did a very fine film titled The Money Movers. It was about a car robbery. It was based on a true story. And Ed and I were in that film together. I did theatre with Phil, with Eddie, and obviously I did the television series Skippy with Ed. So we were very old and good friends until he passed away. Lisa Goddard, who played Clancy in the television in Skippy, who lives now back there in London. You should try and track Lisa down. It'd be interesting to chat to Lisa of her experience in Australia before she went back to London. Mm. I think she did a series back there called Three Girls Sharing.
Right.
So Lisa and I remained and still are good friends. I haven't seen her for many years, but I've sent an email to her and we've stayed connected on email. And the other young actor in it, Ken James, who was in the series. I see Ken kind of often. He lives in Melbourne. I live in Sydney. So Melbourne is about 500 miles south of Sydney, down in Victoria, the capital of Victoria. Ken and I are still very good friends. The actor, the young boy that played Sonny, Gary Pankhurst, after the show finished, after Skippy finished, Gary didn't do anything. He didn't stay in business at all. I didn't see Gary for maybe 20 years. And then there was a reunion of the original cast. And I saw Gary then, who had grown from a little 12-year-old boy. And here he was, this big lump of a guy with a beard. It was quite funny when I met Gary after all that time. Gary's alive. I don't know exactly what he's doing. He's in business in Australia, I believe, up in Queensland, in Brisbane, or on the Gold Coast. I'm not quite sure. But he's still alive. So the only regular member of the show that's passed away is Ed Devereaux.
And a lot of people would probably recognise Ed Devereaux from things like The Persuaders, The New Avengers. Again, he's somebody that pops up a lot in British television.
Correct.
Was it sometimes funny with the kangaroo and some of the puppets they used? Was it sometimes a bit sort of, it took a long time to get stuff sort of done, or was it quite comical sometimes?
Well, it was always comical, Philip. Although it's our national, one of our national animals, I have to be honest, kangaroos aren't overly bright. They're, you can't train a kangaroo to do much. So everything you saw Skippy do in the show were either the kangaroo paws that opened something if Skippy needed to look somewhere, you'd shoot the kangaroo and you'd make a noise, you'd do something so suddenly the kangaroo would turn around and that'd be the edit. So the what's called the second unit, most television series, Philip, have what's called a second unit. The first unit does the actors and the dialogue and the story. The second unit does all the bits and pieces that are needed for that episode. Close-up of something being done, an explosion. All that is done by the second unit and edited into the show in post-production.
Sorry, Tim, just going to bring my light forward slightly. 1 second.
Yeah.
That's a bit better. Do you have a favourite episode from Skippy, from your character's point of view, that always sort of said, oh, that's my favourite, or was it kind of difficult to choose favourites?
I enjoyed them all, I have to be honest, but there was one particular one I liked, maybe because I get ribbed for it by a lot of my friends, and it was an episode called Surf King. We shot it at Avalon Beach here in Sydney, and it was about Jerry, my character, going to a surf carnival. And when I got to the beach, or when Jerry got to the beach, he had to do a rescue. Someone was in trouble in the ocean, and I had to dive in and do this rescue. I got washed up on rocks and got cuts. And then the surf race started, and I was last. Typical kind of television episodic thing. I was last to go in the race, and obviously... I won the race. So it's one that I get ribbed by my friends a lot. A lot of them were always fun to do and interesting to do. Mm-hmm. But I think that episode titled Surf King was one I had fun doing.
Yeah, good. Lovely. Your credit is being 7 episodes. Does that sound right?
207?
Your credit is being in 207 episodes of the show. Does that sound about right? Just check that.
Well, that may have been the whole show. I left. I didn't bring it up a moment ago, and I don't bring it up often. But I left the show because I had a fallout with the producers over my terms of agreement, my contract.
Mm. Yeah.
So they didn't ever, they were a bit naughty. When I left the show and came to England in 1968, the end of 1968, they shot on for about another year or so without me, without my character. Yeah. And they didn't ever tell the viewers that Jerry was no longer in the show. So people were watching the show and for the last year or so, and I wasn't in them. While they were still filming here, I had left and was in England.
I mean, do you ever think about characters like that are not resolved? Do you ever think sort of what happened, the people you play? Do you sort of tend to do a lot of character work in that respect of the past, and where do you sort of, how do you sort of form a role
as an actor? Yeah, no, I understand what you're saying. And many years ago, a production company here in Australia wanted to try and make Skippy again, bring the series back to life. And they asked me if I would be interested in coming into that new series. And I thought, yeah, that'd be interesting. I could have been away maybe in America doing something, and I'd come back to Australia and got involved with the family and the show again. It could have been interesting, but it didn't eventuate. I don't know if they legally were allowed to do it or given the rights to do the series. I'm not quite sure what happened, but I know what you're saying. Sometimes you play something that you think, gee, I wish there was another a new series or another series of episodes that this character could develop. You think of that often, and sometimes it does. I mean, if a show is highly successful and goes into, you know, 10 or 15 years of production, you can do that. But Home and Away, and I know you get Home and Away in England. People that are in Home and Away still Ray Marr, who's a great friend of mine. Ray plays a character in there that he's been with that show for about 22 years. You know, he plays a character called Alf. And, you know, Ray's had an opportunity to start that character 22 years ago and to now. So it's been interesting for Ray to do that. I don't think I'd like to stay with the one show for that long, I've got to be honest. I think two, three years maybe with a television show is kind of long enough because you should have just about done everything you can with the character in that time. And as an actor, you want to play other roles. You want to develop other possibilities. So, I mean, I understand actors that want to stay in a show for a long time because they're guaranteed, obviously, of an income. And I understand that because the acting world is a difficult one at times.
I think it depends on the actor, as you say. Some like to have long runs, but I think the appeal of an actor is so you can play as many things as possible. It's not like a normal 9-to-5 job where you're doing the same thing all the time. It is that excitement, isn't it, that actors like.
Absolutely correct.
I wanted to go in a bit more detail about Can't Win Them All, if that's okay. For such a big film, was there quite a detailed audition process for Can't Win Them All? Was it, how did you get the role for that one?
Which one was that, John?
No, sorry, Can't Win Them All.
Oh, You Can't Win Them All.
Yeah.
No, I was fortunate. I was offered that. Peter Collinson directed You Can't Win Them All. He was about to direct another film out here in Australia, and that was put on the back burner for some reason. And then Columbia Pictures had this script, You Can't Win Them All, available. And Peter had just not long finished that wonderful film that he directed, The Italian Job, which Peter did. So I'm just trying to think now, Philip. I'd done I'd done a film in Malta, Eyewitness, with St. George and Jeremy Kemp and Peter Bowles, Peter Vaughan, terrific film. Mark Lester, little Mark, who played Oliver. And I'd done that film, and Peter somehow heard that I was in it and I'd done it. He was interested in me playing this character in his film, in You Can't Win Them All. The character's name was Reese. It wasn't overly involved at all. Peter called me in. I had a meeting with him. He said, this is the character. Tony Curtis is playing the lead with Charlie Bronson. And this character does this and this and this. And it sounded interesting. It was to be shot in Turkey, which is fascinating, obviously. So that was wonderful. I mean, that really helped my career in England and Europe. Being in that, not only because of the star power of Tony Curtis and Charles Bronson and Peter Collinson as the director, it was good being attached to that film.
As one of those films, so the director of The Italian Job, the star power, you probably weren't going into it thinking, as long as they don't really mess it up, this is going to be a hit.
You had to figure. With the power of Columbia Pictures behind it, those two major stars in the lead, a couple of wonderful Turkish leading actors. I can remember one who became a good friend, Fikret Hakan. So it was always going to be reasonably successful in Turkey, in the kind of Mediterranean Arab countries. And with Tony Curtis and Charles Bronson, it was always going to be successful in America and Europe. I mean, especially the people in France loved Charlie Bronson, you know. So it was, and everyone in England kind of likes Charlie and Tony Curtis. So it was a reasonably successful film. So it was great to be a part of that.
And would you have gone to the premiere? Would you sort of have enjoyed that part of it, the glamour side of it?
Yeah. It premiered obviously in America and then in the West End. So that's all part of the obligation. If you're playing one of the lead roles, part of your obligation as the actor is not only to do the work and play the character, but is to help promote the film.
Mm. And you enjoy promoting things. I imagine some people might find it a bit laborious.
Yeah, I did, and I always have. All the films that I've done, that the producers have asked me to go on a promotional tour with the film, various capitals. It's always, for me, it's a part of the process of being a film actor. You don't do theater, you know, when you're doing a play in the theater, you open, you hope to get reasonably good reviews, and it's the reviews of the play that will bring the audience into the theater to see the play. It's similar, I suppose, with film, but there's so much pre-publicity done with films that they can kind of guarantee that they'll have an audience. So, but yeah, that's part of the obligation, Philip, of being an actor is promoting the film you're in, or play you're in, whatever, or the television show, whatever you're doing. That's part of your obligation is to promote that project.
Yeah. Do you remember meeting Tony Curtis for the first time? I imagine that's something that might perhaps stick with you.
Yeah, we just kind of hit it off, you know. He had a great sense of humour, as most people that have ever worked with him would attest to. He is a kind of joker. He's great. I mean, I liked him a lot. I liked most of the films that Tony did as an actor. I thought some of his choices in the work he's done were always interesting. Of course, he'd done some films that I would imagine he wished he hadn't have done. We've all kind of done that to a degree. Because sometimes you're contracted to do three or four films, and you're obligated to do those films. You know, you just got to hope that all the scripts have some merit to them. Sometimes, unfortunately, they don't. Tony and I got along wonderfully on that film. We all went back to London after shooting You Can't Win Them All. That's when Tony started, a little later, started the television series with Roger Moore, The Persuaders. And I was fortunate to play the guest lead in one of those episodes. So it was wonderful to reunite again with Tony Curtis and to work for the first time with Roger, who became a lifelong friend. We were just really good pals, Roger and Roger Moore and I. It's a funny journey, Philip. Sometimes I don't plan too many things. It's just the way my life's worked is something always comes and presents itself to do. I don't kind of have a game plan. I don't sit and plan ahead. I'm not that kind of person. I just do the best that I can with the role I've been asked to play now, and I kind of hope, I imagine that I hope the project that I'm doing is successful, and obviously I hope that the character that I'm playing in there has merit and is successful for a producer director to see me in a future project. And they then send me a script and I read and see if I want to do the next one.
Did shooting in Turkey on You Can't Win Them All pose any issues, or was it quite a pleasant shoot in Turkey?
Yeah, I think it was pretty pleasant. I think the production company, Tura Films, the Turkish co-producers in Turkey with Colombia, I think, and it was only natural when, because we filmed out in some very remote and difficult places in Turkey. It's an interesting film to see, beside hopefully the story of the film. Visually, it's fabulous. You know, we filmed in Istanbul, we filmed south down to Kushadasi and Ephesus, and then we filmed into central Antalya, into Gorome, into Ankara. So we covered quite a look of Turkey. So visually, it's a splendid film. And the story's interesting. You know, it's a band of kind of leftover people from the First World War that were mercenaries for hire in Europe. And we were hired by these people in Turkey to get the Quran, the holy book. And that's kind of what it was about. And then all the problems that happened within the storyline. So, yeah, it was good fun. I love Turkey. I went back several times. I wrote a documentary on the country. I found it intriguing and interesting. I had a very close friend there, a lady friend that is still a friend to this day, which is extraordinary. You know, I'm now talking like 40, 45 years ago. And we're still great friends and talk quite a lot on Facebook and Messenger and Instagram and the rest of it. So, yeah, I've been blessed in my work and my career. I think, Philip, just about everyone, I can't think of anyone I've worked with that I've taken offence to or disliked or had never wanted to see again. I don't have those sort of dramas in my life. No, yeah. Everyone... they're all like family to me.
Oh, that's wonderful. I want to just mention that the female lead of Can't Win Them All, Michelle Mercer. Do you remember her at all, Michelle?
Work, obviously, not obviously, but my character wasn't involved too much with Michelle. She was mainly involved with Tony Curtis and Charlie. There were a couple of scenes where we're all in the same scene, but no, I didn't have a lot of involvement with her either personally. I didn't because she didn't work the same hours as we all did. So I didn't have breakfast, lunch or dinner with her because I didn't. She was not available or gone or doing whatever she was doing. Because she wasn't in the whole film with all of us, she came in and just like as a cameo more than anything. So I didn't have a lot to do. I had a lot to do with the German actor, Horst Janssen. Horst and I became great friends and are still great friends. Horst went back to Germany and did a big circus television series character. He played in that. He's done a lot of work in Germany, Horst. Leo Gordon, the guy that wrote the script, Leo V. Gordon, who was one of the close friends of the great John Wayne. Leo did a lot of Westerns with John Wayne. So it was great talking to Leo, and we were good pals. And Leo V. Gordon wrote that script for that film, and he was on the picture with us. All the stuntmen, all the guys, were most of the stunt guys that did all the James Bond films out of Pinewood. It was great. I just loved it. I mean, I always love filming on location. It's hard enough to love it.
So it takes you out of the normal humdrum sort of side of it. And I've interviewed quite a few people that can't win them all, is on their CV, Bond people, etc. There's a lady I was quite friendly with, when he didn't continuity on Can't Win Them All. She recently passed away in the mid-90s, so she had a good run. But yeah, just where almost everybody of a certain, you know, caliber worked on, as it were.
Yeah.
I mean, was it quite unusual to have the writer on location? Like, was it sort of adapted a little bit just in case anything kind of changed, or?
No. He was in it because he was an actor and was right for the role. Leo wasn't there as a writer to give Peter Collinson, the director, any thoughts or any rewrites or no. He was once he'd written the script, delivered the script to Peter. Peter had read the script, wanted some changes. There's always changes to be made. Once that was all kind of put to bed, Leo was just employed then as an actor playing a character. I wouldn't think too many people, even the other actors, or the close actors would have, obviously, but most of the people, even on the crew, wouldn't have known that Leo wrote the script. You know, he was there as an actor to play a character.
I just wanted to mention one other actor in the film, the guy who played Davis, John Atchison. I think I'm pronouncing that right. Do you remember him at all?
Oh yeah, very much so. He was great. John and I were really good pals. I don't know what he's done. I really haven't had any contact with or knowledge of John for maybe 35 or 40 years. So if he's still alive, and I hope he is, I don't know if he stayed in film, went back to theatre. He loved theatre. I don't know. If you ever track down through British Equity or something, Julian, Philip, would you pass on my regard if he's still alive?
I'm just looking him up now, because one reason why he piqued my interest was, again, he was the main guest star in the first episode of that show. Okay. Not many credits, really. His last credit was 1976, the Doctor Who. He did a Department S episode, which was a popular show over here. So I'm guessing more sort of theatre was his passion. He did sadly die in February 1998.
Oh, so, well.
I don't have a year of birth for him at all. But I think he might be one of those people that there's perhaps not too much perhaps known about him, perhaps.
I don't know what happened, as I'm suggesting, when the film finished and we all kind of went back to London. I basically, not long after that, either went to Africa to do that film in Africa, or the Persuaders. And I can't quite think. I'd have to look at my resume, Philip, to remember what I did. But I think we had a couple of drinks in London, not long after we got back, and then we kind of parted. I just didn't see him. So I'm sorry that he's no longer with us. We got along great. John, he was a very kind of military sort of fellow. John, I liked him a lot.
I should correct myself quickly, Tony. John played sort of a henchman in the Persuaders. I was thinking about another person that was in the episode. I'm trying to think who it is. John Alderson, I think, who also was in can't win them all. He had a lead role in the Persuaders.
Well, I know both of them, so it'll be interesting. I didn't know he did a Persuaders role as well. That's interesting.
I mean, what was John Alderson like?
Good fellow. Yeah, good. Again, it's been kind of 40 years since I've seen John. I don't know, and I didn't really know what he got up to after that. But yeah, it's funny. This industry, Philip, you can do a film with someone, become really like brothers, and then you may never work with them again the rest of your life. You know, it's really a bizarre industry. You know, for the moment that 6, 8 weeks or 10 weeks or whatever you're together on that film, it's like that wonderful television series, A Band of Brothers. You become a band of brothers, and then the family kind of breaks up and everyone goes their own way.
I mean, do you get used to that as an actor, or is it always kind of a bit difficult sometimes to...
Well, it's, yeah, you get used to it. It's difficult because you sometimes make really close connections with someone and the show finishes. It's even harder in theatre because you can be in the one play and tour whatever country or the world. You can be in that play for 2 years. You know, when you're touring with a big musical, you'll play 6 months in this major city, then you'll play, you know, 4 months in another major city, and then you travel. And so you can be in the same show with people for like 2 years, sometimes longer.
Do you have a favourite scene from Can't Win Them All, or a favourite moment for your character?
Nothing jumps out or I'd mention it, but the scene that I do remember was a very big scene we had in the now city of Izmir, which back in this period was called Smyrna, when the Greeks owned it, before the Greeks were driven out of Turkey, which is about the time we were doing the period that this film was set in. That was a big scene. A lot of camera coverage, a lot of extras, a lot of explosions, a lot of bomb, a lot of big stuff. I mean, only scenes that you can only do really on film because of the size of it. You know, today a scene like that would be shot probably in a studio with a blue screen or green screen, or it'd be done in post-production, CGI, which is all the popular now. When all those kind of films I'm talking about, all the effects, all the stunts were there live on the set.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can't beat that realism, can you? That sort of.
I agree. I love it. I wish the hell it would come back. I mean, you do work now as an actor, and sometimes you don't. It's all being done in post-production. The director will say, see that little mark on the wall there, Tony? I want you to look at that mark. That's where, you know, the bullet's coming or the arrow's coming or something. You never see what's going on. You've got to. This is why work as an actor these days is technically so different from when you were an actor 20 years ago. Now you have to understand the ADR work you've got to do. Most dialogue you do always on American projects. You're doing all your dialogue once again in post-production, in ADR.
Yeah.
You know, and it's very difficult for some actors who are basically theatre trained to play a scene here on the set, do the dialogue, bang, bang, everything happens here. And now 2 months later, you're going to get a call and you have to go into an ADR studio put earphones on, watch a screen, and revoice what you did 2 months ago. And it's difficult for some actors.
Oh, yeah, 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 I can imagine. There does seem to be interesting at the moment with cinema, because we've had some couple of big blockbuster CGI films that have not done well at the box office, and you're getting things like the latest John Wick film, which have done very, very well. It's very popular. So maybe there's a sense that the audience is hankering for less of the CGI, more sort of things done for real. So maybe, hopefully, it will go that way.
Bravo!
Yeah, hopefully. I just wanted to mention Peter Collinson, of course, a fabulous, as you mentioned. What, in your opinion, made him an exceptionally good director?
Oh, hard to say from a specific point of view, other than because I've only ever worked, we became good pals and had lots of talks and discussions on emotions and on what you discuss with a director, but I've only worked with him on one film. I'd love to work with him on a drama, a smaller, more intimate drama, but he had those abilities. So Peter had the ability to shoot on a big scale, on a big film where you've got hundreds of extras and action, and you can't lose your leading characters. So Peter was a very good director's actor, and I'd like to have worked with him more, but it just didn't happen that way in England. But all I can say is my time with Peter as a friend, as a human being, as a director, and the director-actor relationship on You Can't Win Them All was fabulous.
Oh, fantastic. We mentioned last time, Quigley Down Under, and you mentioned that, of course, you were quite close with Alan Rickman. Was there a specific memory of filming with Alan that stays with you?
No, I would be creating a moment that purely for this discussion. Nothing that jumps out, other than at no time in the scenes that I did with Alan and the scenes that I witnessed him doing that I didn't see an actor in character being that character and finding the interesting moments that made that character interesting. And that's what made Alan the actor that he was. You remember him in everything he did.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, the intensity, the dedication he brings to his roles was fabulous.
I agree. So in that sense, I loved working with him. The scenes, that because I played his foreman in the film, he was my boss. So we had several scenes, and I always enjoyed them. It was this, because I have a certain intensity about myself when I work, and I love it. It's like a foil, like a rapier. It's like a fencing game. I'll lunge, he'll parry, he'll lunge, I'll parry. But we do that in moments, looks, breathing, and the dialogue. It's fabulous.
Oh, yeah, so that's a wonderful relationship to have. The other person in the film, Laura San Giacomo. Do you remember her at all?
Oh, she's fabulous. I worked with her in that film, only in two scenes. Again, she was mainly involved with Tom Selleck's character. So it was mainly with Tommy. The couple of scenes she was with us, the other guys, were fabulous, because she's she's just fun, which you can tell from the film that really started her, when she played the hooker.
Pretty Woman.
Yeah.
Pretty Woman.
So she was great. She was vital. She was just great. I mean, I'd seen very little of her work before that, and then she did the television series about the newsroom in America, and she was great in that. I don't know. I haven't seen Laura. I hope she's still with us. I haven't seen Laura San Giacomo pop up in anything in a long time, and she was a very good actress. So I hope she's fine. But she was a joy to work with. It was a tough film for her and any of the women in the film, because we were in the middle of Australia. It was hot, dusty, not pleasant working situations. But she didn't play any kind of star role. She just pitched in and did what she could do. It was great.
She's still going. I've looked up on IMDb, and yeah, she's still around, thankfully. Still acting, got different credits to her name, sort of TV shows, NCIS, sort of fed recently. So still, in my research for you, Tony, I did see, but it's not on your IMDb page, so I'm not sure whether you actually did one, but did you do Hawaii 5-0?
Didn't do a 5-0, no. I knew two of the actors in it. And I was in Hawaii. I was going through Hawaii on my way back to Los Angeles once when they were shooting, and I stopped and saw the guys. No, I didn't do a 5-0. I'd like to have done a 5-0, but no, I didn't, no.
Did you ever meet Jack Lord?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Because again, a huge name, of course. Your memories.
Yeah. No. I just knew Jack from that show. I didn't really see anything else that Jack did, film wise or television wise, after he finished there. So. Yeah, I don't know what he got up to, but I know he had a great following. I got a feeling he's no longer with us either.
Afraid not, no. I think he died many years ago. Bond fans, of course, know him as the first Felix Leiter in Dr. No. I was wondering, have you ever had to learn anything for a film or TV? Have learnt, if that makes sense, of a particular skill, or learn a musical instrument or something like that for a while?
No, not as such. I suppose. Hang on, I did. I keep on forgetting things, Philip. I played a blind racing car driver that was blinded in a racing car accident in a movie for television many years ago. And I went to the Blind Institute in Melbourne here in Australia to learn how to use a braille watch, to learn how to use the cane, to learn because I wanted to play the character without dark glasses. I didn't want to hide behind dark glasses because I was a blind person. So that was interesting. To play a scene, be looking at someone and yet not seeing them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I enjoyed that aspect of learning the braille that I needed to learn exactly how to use the collapsible white cane, how to be a blind person. It was extremely rewarding, interesting, and I, as I do with everything I learn, I have a greater respect for people that have lost their sight in the manner in which they need to live. I could always ride a horse. I've done a lot of big horse films. I could always box pretty well. So anything with guns, rifles, handguns, shotguns, knives, any physicality, surfing, horses, cars. I've done, I suppose, 80% of all the stunts in film and television I've done, except fire. I treat fire with the greatest of respect. I nearly killed myself on a television series a long time ago that I end up winning some awards for playing this man. But in one sequence where it's, a house was on fire, a friend of mine in the show, in the film, and I went and to knock the door down, and obviously the fire was staged inside with gas. And we presumed that when I hit the door, that the door would swing open. Hmm. And the door didn't swing open. Because of the fire burning inside the room, the fire had burnt through the timber around the hinges on the door. So when I hit the door with my elbow, the door completely fell in, pushed the air across and the flames across the room to hit the wall, and the flame came back at me.
Right.
So with knocking the door down, within two heartbeats, this wall of flame came rushing back at me and bowled me over, burnt my eyebrows off. So from then on, anything that had to do with fire in any film or television, I'd say to the stunt guys, this one's yours. Mm. I'm going near the fire.
Well, what was the name of that production? Do you recall?
The film was called End of Summer. It was a film for ABC Television Melbourne. The great and wonderful Oscar Whitbread directed that. This man I played right from the beginning of the film, he was in trouble. His property, his ranch had been decimated with drought. His stock was dying. His family had left him because it was just too difficult living there. They went back to the city. It was a difficult film to do because the character at no stage during the film was joyful or happy because of the circumstances he lived in. So when you play a character like that, so the audience just doesn't go crazy because they're so fucking bored, every scene is down and depressing. You need to have a passion and an interest in the man you're playing that hopefully an audience is going along for the journey with this character, that at some stage fortune changes for him, things change for him. And I think we achieved that with the great direction of Oscar and the wonderful script. I mean, just the script won awards for the script. Oscar won awards for his direction. I won an award for the performance. I loved that. It was just, that's the sort of work I like doing as an actor.
Hmm. You mentioned, of course, that you've done a lot of TV shows, some as a guest star. What's it like coming in as a new person into an established show? Is it always nice? Does it depend on the production, the people?
Yeah, it can, I imagine. But if I go into a show as a guest lead in an episode, I've done it because the character, the man, interests me that I've been asked to play, or I wouldn't do it. To this stage in my life, and I can't see me changing now, Philip, I've never done anything for money. I've done it because I felt I needed or wanted to do it. So if I go into a show like The Persuaders, as a guest lead, up with two powerful lead actors in Tony Curtis and Roger Moore, who respected the energy that I was giving the character I was playing, and I respected their positions in the fraternity of actors, that they'd both done enough work that they were now established stars. And I was an actor on the journey. They respected me. They respected my intensity, my thought, my trying to find moments to make this man interesting. So that's how I've always approached it. When I did Murder, She Wrote in Los Angeles with the great characters in that, Angela Lansbury, Dame Angela Lansbury, wonderful Canadian actor was in it, Len Carreyrou. Len was an extraordinary Broadway star. A lot of people that watch Len's work on television, primarily in film, don't realize what a star he was on Broadway when he came out of Canada. So that was the same thing. You know, I had to work with Dame Angela Lansbury, who was nothing but charming and supportive and talented and wonderful. Len Carreyrou, someone I respected for his Broadway work. Jenny Agata, played my wife in that, you know, and Jenny's work as an actress in England and around the world is wonderful. She's got such a wonderful feel for her work, Jenny. So, to walk on a set with these people, all you want to do is the best you can do. And in doing that, hopefully you find moments that are interesting, not just for you, but for your fellow actors. You know, because if someone's being interesting, it fires you up. You want to be interesting. I've been fortunate, Philip, that's what's happened to me in just about everything I've done. I've done it because I wanted to do it, because of the interest. Is it a challenge? Can I do this? Can I play this man and have an audience believe him?
Oh, yeah. I was very fortunate to see Angela Lansbury when she came to the West End. She did Blythe Spirit. I think she's about 90. Yep. Running around the stage like somebody in her 40s, you know, if not younger, you know, fantastic energy she had.
It was, and that's how she was, you know.
Also in your Murder, She Wrote episode, there was an actor, Bernard Fox. Did you encounter him at all?
I did, Bernard, yeah. Yeah. I'm just trying to relate. Do you have that IMDb? What we were in then?
Yes. Well, the episode itself was called "One White Rose for Death." That was the episode of
Murder, She Wrote.
Yeah.
Bernard played a Dutchman, and he was trying to. He was one of the bad guys in it. No, I know exactly who you're talking about. We had great fun on that because we had several friends, actors in London and back in Australia that Bernard had worked with and who I knew and had worked with. So, yes, I do remember it.
Oh, wonderful. Again, one of those faces that pops up in loads of things, The Man from U.N.C.L.E. Most people might remember him as the... retired Air Force captain in The Mummy, the Brendan Fraser version. One thing I must mention, quite a notable TV appearance, the young Indiana Jones Chronicles.
Yes, we shot that.
Because that was 1993, and you had Catherine Zeta-Jones, Daniel Craig as well.
Correct.
A good production.
It was. I mean, the great man produced that, as you know, Mr. Star Wars.
Yes.
Yeah, it was his production company, and that was fabulous. Isn't it strange to work with Daniel when he was just a, as we call it in the business, a jobbing actor before, you know, well before Bowden came along. And Catherine was on her way. She just finished doing the series, The Darling Buds of May, for I think the BBC or ITV, I'm not quite sure. But she was on her way to try America.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you get the sense of... Oh, sorry, go on, Tony.
Oh, no. She'd finished her career at that stage in England, was shooting the thing that we were all doing in Turkey, and then she was heading straight to America to try her luck there.
Hmm. I mean, well, when you work with certain actors like Cavendish Jones, Daniel Craig, on the way up, do you kind of notice or to watch? Do you kind of get a sense that they might break it, but you know, might really break it big?
I did with Catherine, because he had that Welsh, that exquisite kind of Welsh interest to her. She was obviously extraordinarily beautiful, attractive, but with that, she was interesting. I mean, there's lots of beautiful women. There's not a lot of beautiful, interesting women. And she was. So I kind of would look at Catherine when we were having lunch or dinner or something and kind of think, yeah, with the right role, with the right door opening for you and the right role, you're gonna make it there. She had that feel to her. Daniel, I have to be surprised if you had told me then that he was going to be James Bond in 20 years' time. I would have said, I don't think so. Not from any ability, but you know, he wasn't a Bond then.
Yeah, so not in the traditional, you know, what you mean. You know, he wasn't a Roger Moore, he wasn't a Connery type, you know, very sort of different as an actor. It wasn't really. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm.
He wasn't a Bond type.
Mm.
You know.
I mean, well, was it quite a good production to be on? Because obviously, with George Lucas in it, did you. Production.
Oh yeah, no, it was fabulous to be on. One, because I thought the series overall was an interesting series, the Young Indie Chronicles. Loved the concept of a new show, a new episode each week or each time it played. There was kind of continuing storyline, you got a fresh kind of story each time it played. So I thought the concept of the show was interesting, and I loved the part that I'd done because I'd already done the feature film, The Light Horseman. What we did in The Young Indie Chronicles, why I was cast in it, is that Lucas had seen the film that I was in called the Light Horseman, which was the Australian Light Regiment in the First World War, that charged the cannons and machine guns at Beersheba in Palestine. And it was a wonderful victory. And I think it was the last cavalry charge as such in war. And the man I played, Lieutenant Colonel William Bouchier, led that charge. So it was a fabulous film to do. I'll tell you who else was in the from England was Anthony Andrews.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
He played an English character that became involved, and it was based on a true story. George Lucas bought parts of the film to then edit that into his series. So he needed made to go to Turkey to now link the bits that we shot in Turkey into the footage that we bought.
Yeah, well, that's interesting.
Oh, it was great.
Yeah. And again, Anthony Andrews, a pleasant chap.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, great fun. Because I'd loved Anthony ever since he did with Lions, Brideshead Revisited.
I thought
one of the great shows.
It is indeed, yes. Yes, fabulous.
So it was wonderful. I hadn't met Anthony in England when I was doing my bits in London. I don't know what he was doing in the late 60s and 70s. He may not have even started then. But when he came out to Australia to play the character in the film here, The Light Horseman, it was great. It was wonderful.
I did want to ask about the relationship that an actor has with success and fame. Is it always, when you do have those big films as big hits as TV series, is it keep a level head because you've got all the strappings that might come with fame? How do you sort of manage that aspect of it? How do you keep sort of down to earth as an actor?
Oh, I'm not the sort of human being that gets off earth, Philip. Mm. You know, I genuinely love what I do. I love teaching. I was teaching today before I came back to do this chat with you. I love trying to help a young actor not go through some of the stupidity I went through as an actor by being brutally honest with them of what they need to do and the work they need to do and the outlook and the philosophy and the love they need to have. I'm not that sort of person. I know actors that are. Maybe I would like to have had, and still today, but it's a bit late now, but when I was a younger actor, I'd like to have had a little more, not self-importance, but I'd like to have it's just difficult. I'd like to have just been a little more, I can't think of the correct phrase, Philip. It's about self-esteem. I have always have had a very low self-esteem, which is a kind of strangeness when, you know, I can walk out on a stage with 1,000 people in the audience and yet sometimes I find it difficult being in a room with people. I've never got ahead of myself. I've just been really grateful that work has come along that I've found interesting, and the group of actors and the director, we've worked in harmony to try and bring out the magic in whatever we're doing. I'm not an inflated person, Philip. I know people that are, and God bless them for having that bit of more push, I suppose. I've never been a pushed person.
So as you say, it's the work that kind of sort of keeps you grounded and that's your focus. And I mean, I have met quite a few actors, you know, a lot of them in person. Rowan Atkinson, very, very person, always on the stage, or his TV shows. So I think a lot of actors do, you know, have that sort of, that they like the script, they know what they're doing when they've got that environment, but outside perhaps, just like everybody, you know, we all have, and I think it's probably healthy to have self-doubt. It's often those people that I don't like or like less tend to be those that have a strong self-belief point where they're, you know, it almost becomes a bit too, bit arrogant. So I'd say on the more sort of self-doubt side of it, I think it's the more healthy way to be, really.
Oh, no, I understand what you're saying, and I agree with you. People that I've worked with that have not the ability that maybe they should have, but have an arrogance about themselves, I tend not to socialise with. I tend not to want to be in their company.
Oh, yeah. I just wanted to finish off. I just want to mention some of your other achievements, because we did receive a Lifetime Achievement Award fairly recently. I wonder what it was like to have that kind of recognition.
Oh, well, it's, again, we're in Australia, Philip, and there's not a lot of recognition here for awards or for achieving something. We have a love for someone that's done something that has been of worth, but we don't kind of go out of our way to express to them what we think, you know, how great they are or how worthy they are, or that's kind of not in the Australian character or manner, which is both good and bad, I have to say. The Order of Australia that I received for my services to the arts, primarily, and to life saving and to the charities I help, it came out of the blue. I had no idea they'd put me up for it. I had no idea the Canberra, their capital, did it all. I just received a letter from the government saying, you know, you have been honoured with this. There'll be a function at Government House. So it was wonderful. I was pleased for my daughters, I suppose, because of the strange manner in which I've lived and gone without certain things, and I hoped they were proud of it, and I'm sure they were and are. But it's not spoken about a lot. If my name goes into something, it's Tony Bonner AM for the Order of Australia. It's just attached to your name now as a notation, which is nice. I don't revel about it, Philip. Mm. I'm of great gratitude and am honoured that I received it, certainly.
Mm. It's a nice thing to have, isn't it? And it's always nice to be recognised by what we do.
You're right. I mean, that's the bottom line of it, I imagine, is that that this group that sanctioned who gets these awards saw merit in not only what I've done in film, theatre and television over all these years in all the countries, but I've done it as an Australian, and they honoured me for that fact, I think.
I just want to finish off by asking about your work with your surf club, Manly Beach Surf Club, and the charity work you do, and how important is that to you and in your life?
Oh, well, it's hugely important, Philip. It's the Manly Life Saving Club that I'm a member of. My grandfather was the first president of this club over 100 years ago. I've been president of it three times over the last 30 years. It's service based. I like being of service to the community. I've had the fortune to drag quite a few people out of the ocean and save them, or someone falls down with a heart attack in a restaurant or is choking or something, you can do something because you've done it, you know, and you've learned something where you can be of service. So, and it's like my second family. When I walk into the Lifesaving Club, I'm not Tony Bonner, AM, actor, well-known, all that. I'm just, I'm Bonza. That's my nickname, Bonza. I'm just one of the guys, you know, and it's great. We're a family. The movement is great. So I love it. And the charities I'm involved with, I've been a member of the Variety Club, which I joined with Roger Moore and Susan George in London in 1969, I think. I joined the Variety Club in London. And then when I came back to Australia, the Variety Club was just starting back here. And I became a committee member, and now I'm an ambassador for the Variety Club, which I'm really honoured. The work that the Variety Club internationally has done for underprivileged and handicapped children is phenomenal. Phenomenal. So I've been with them for 50 years. I'm with the Smith family. I'm with two charities for children for abuse and sexual abuse and violence to children, Brave Hearts. The great lady, Hetty Johnson, runs that. So, yeah, quite a few charities and organisations that I'm a member of or an ambassador for, which I, you know, I've got three healthy daughters, so whatever I can do to help kids that don't have the same shot, then you bet. Just being of service, that's all, Phil.
Well, it sounds wonderful. I mean, you're obviously very not big headed about it, but it's a wonderful thing that you do, and you know, hugely important. Is there anything in your, just a last final question, is there anything that you still want to do? Is there still a type of role or something you, more directing perhaps? Is it, what's this current phase of your life? What do you see going forward?
All that, what you just mentioned. I'm the right age, and I'm kind of right now to have a crack at playing Lear, King Lear. I like teaching, so hopefully I can stay passionate enough and healthy enough to keep teaching. Yes, directing. I'd like to direct more theatre. I love it. The last play I did was One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. I directed for Queensland Theatre. It was just wonderful. Just a wonderful journey with the cast and the journey of rehearsals and workshopping certain moments and then having an audience become a part of that institution. That's what the manner in which I directed it. I wanted the audience to feel that they weren't watching a play as such. They were part of this institution, and I wanted them to question possibly their own mental state to understand the certain characters that were on that stage playing people that were confused and lost, in a except for the lead, J. McMurphy, you know. But McMurphy's attitude gets him lobotomized, you know. And then the big Indian chief kills him because he's no longer McMurphy. It's a journey. It's Billy Bippet is one of the great characters. He kills Nurse Ratched. It's a I like theatre, but I like, as I do with my films that I go and see, or hopefully I'm in, but I like character-driven material, you know, not plot-driven, not car chases and guns and bombs and, I love all that in context, but I basically like going on a journey with the characters.
Yeah, something you can only very much, you can only really do in theatre, isn't it? Sort of, it's always character based. It's, and of course you've got that relationship with the audience. The audience gives you instant feedback, and you can of course change what you're doing as well. As film, it's all locked off, and you can't do anything.
Is that
more rewarding being in theatre in a way, because you can sort of play. A lot of people might say, well, you do it 8 times a week, therefore it's going to be, you know, how do you keep your interest? But I suppose you're always tinkering a little bit, aren't you, with the performance or delivery or an aspect of
it? Yeah, only because, Philip, each day we're not the same. Each day we slightly change. So when I'm doing a play, the character I'm playing, he will still have the same goals, motives, aspirations, dialogue that I did last night, but tonight I may just have a slightly different edge to what I'm doing. It'll be the same journey, but yeah, I might just find a moment in tonight's performance that I didn't find last night, and that makes it interesting for all the cast.
It's keeping it fresh, isn't it?
Well, it's fresh. It's new every performance.
Well, I think that's probably a very nice place to end it, Tony. Is there anything else you wanted to add before we go?
Really, Philip, I've always enjoyed these chats with you. I just hope I can get back to London once more before I leave this earth. I'd just love to walk around the West End again and go to a lot of little bars and restaurants and places that I went to a lot once, and go back to my old apartment in Knightsbridge, even stand outside and look at the walk down Beecham Place as I did every day of my life in London. I hope to get back there. And my football team, Chelsea, is still going okay.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it'd be lovely if you, well, maybe even do a play here or something like that, perhaps. But you've done theatre here, haven't you? A little bit.
No. I'm very happy to wander down that trail as well. It just didn't work. I was asked to do a play, but I had to commit to a certain time on the play, and there was the possibility of a film at that same time. So I could. Yeah. Marry them up. It was just too difficult.
I mean, I've seen most things in the West End, but occasionally Broadway, and there is a distinct difference, I think, in audiences, British, American. How is the Australian audience in terms of how they engage with theatre? Is it noticeably different from other audiences?
I don't think so. Most of the international actors that I know or have worked with here have always had a great love for the Australian audiences. You know, they, always. When the Royal Shakespeare Company always used to come out and tour here, they loved the seasons that they played out here. When the big American musicals come in, now we've got Australian leads that will usually play those leads in the big American musicals, but up until like maybe 10 or 15 years ago, the leads would come in from America to play the music. They loved it, always loved it here, always.
And is Shakespeare a big part of the Australian theatre? Maybe not perhaps the same as the West End, but...
Yeah, it's not as entrenched as in London, but the Shakespeare Company here in Australia does some very fine work. And there, they usually mount two productions a year of Shakespeare, bards, plays, and they'll play, and then the theatre companies, if that happens, if the Bell Company opens a play here in Sydney, when they did Caesar here, then the theatre companies in Brisbane, down in Melbourne, in South Australia, and Perth will send someone over to look at the production, and then they may mount their own production of that play in their theatre company in their state.
And is Shakespeare something that you've always enjoyed playing?
Yes, I have. We did it in the old days here. We used to do Shakespeare in jeans. What they used to try and do was to attract usually a young audience where the characters weren't wearing the usual Shakespearean garb. And they just had the actors in jeans and sweatshirts, and they humanized Shakespeare, which was done a little bit in, I'm trying to remember the film now that the Australian director did in America.
Baz Luhrmann did Romeo and Juliet. Correct.
Theatre has always been very active in Australia. It was, as it was in most countries, far more active until television came along and video came along, and that slowed things down a little. But it's always, there's always been, I used to tour a little bit back in the 60s and 70s. We'd go on tour to the major like the touring theatre in London, in England.
National theatre.
The National does tour, obviously.
Yeah.
But those the provincial areas. It's where actors go to learn their craft. I've just got a mind block at the moment. But repertory theatre.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
So where you do the rep tours in England, we used to do a similar tour here in Australia. You'd rehearse in Sydney, then you would go out and play the major big regional areas in nice theatres, usually. And that was fabulous. That's a great way to learn your craft on rep tours.
And lastly, Tony, were you ever nervous doing theatre, or do you have a moment on stage where you thought this is perfect, sort of moment?
I've always had a kind of interesting nervousness, nothing that was perceivable to an audience, but it just kept me on edge. It kept me in the moment. It's interesting. I think it's interesting to have that awareness that you need to stay in the moment.
And what is the role on stage that you really enjoyed the most, or you just thought it, as a production, it went really, past it?
I suppose there's been a few. I had fun playing Captain Peacock in Are You Being So?
Oh, right, yes.
The great man came out from England to play the lead. We toured that Australia and New Zealand. And I love playing Peacock in that one. Great. All right, mate.
Well, great talking to you. Real pleasure as always, Tony. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Philip. It's always a joy. Thank you.
Take care. Have a nice week.
Thanks, mate. Same to you. And congratulations on the coronation yesterday. I watched most of it on television. I was really proud of just the manner in everything that the English people did, supporting Charles III. I thought it was wonderful.
Yeah, we're very good at that kind of pageantry, aren't we? So, yeah.
No one that does it better.
No. No, that's right. Yeah, it was interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, it was great. All right, mate. Yeah. Thank you.
That's fine. Take care, Tony. All the best.